Crumb TV.
And until we can come together and operate homogeneously, we have no need to vote.
Stay fly. Stay fly.
Get true. Stop being friends with these people. Look, what is your commitment to the black community? Because
disclosure. The Snatched Podcast is profane, politically incorrect, political insensitive, anti-organized religion, and is not safe for children or safe for work. Please listen responsibly.
You're about to get snatched.
Y'all listening to the Snatched Podcast.
Warning, if you listen to this, you're feeling so tired.
We are the Crumb Snatcher. Get snatched.
Snatched.
Peace.
Islam.
Ashe.
Shalom. Rahubet.
Peace.
Hotep. Grand Rising.
Peace.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ashe.
Islam.
Shalom.
So before we get into it, please subscribe to my YouTube page. It's the YouTube page that says Crumb at the top.
Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam.
That's what it is. That's what
you are. You're listening to the Fly Guy Show. They do everything on the fly and in such a fly manner. Stay fly.
The views expressed on the Fly Guy Podcast by the guests of the Fly Guy Podcast are only the views of the guests, unless we say we agree, unless explicitly stated.
Hey, this is Ernie Thomas here on the Bold School Podcast. You're listening to SekoVarner's Fly Guy Podcast. Support, like, subscribe, and share. He's saying some good things. Share it. Don't keep it to yourself.
All right, 3, 2, 1. It's your man DJ SekoVarner for another episode of the Fly Guys Podcast. Got a lot of fly folk in the room tonight. We're gonna do some big stuff tonight. It's gonna be popping. Crumb snatches on it, so it's probably gonna be profane. Be ye prepared. Crumb, what's good? What's your movement, man?
Peace and love, brother Seiko. Salute to the Fly Guy Podcast. I am your humble brother, Crumb Snatcher. Seiko calls me woke on steroids, on caffeine, and maybe even crack. I'm on Facebook, on Instagram, I'm on YouTube, Crumb TV. I'm just here as voice of the people to wake everybody up. Thank you for having me, brother.
No doubt. Star, what's good, girl? What's your movement?
Greetings, everybody. How are y'all doing? I'm Starr Armstrong, founder and president of Clever Communities in Action, a nonprofit that focuses on literacy and positive cultural representation for Black youth. You can find more information about that at clevercommunities.org. We are CCIA_org on Instagram, Clever Communities in Action on Facebook. Yeah, that's where you can find us. And we have an event coming up on the 24th, a back-to-school cookout and school supply giveaway on August the 24th. And we're inviting the community to come out, and we're also asking the community to support the efforts by contributing.
Good stuff. Shay, what's good? What's your movement?
Hello, all. I am Shay Malone. I am the founder and executive director of Families for His Glory. We create equity through education. And so we do educational services for students with special needs, including reading intervention, as well as health and wellness. And we promote inclusion and diversity through community outreach. So you can find us all over the web at Families4HG. Families4HG, except for on Twitter, we are Fams4HG.
That's what's up. All right, so Clev or Star had this great idea about talking about politics and voting our agenda, and I was just kind of blown away. Said, "Hey, we need to get back on the horn, do this podcast." And so I'm honored to have all of you on here. Speaking of honored, Star called me an honorary woman. I'm still getting over that.
You know you liked it. Everybody liked it.
Still know how to take that. So look, Star, why were you so passionate about discussing voting and our agenda?
Well, first of all, because my life is dedicated to the empowerment of our community. And I feel like we get this whole political thing wrong in a lot of ways. We do politics based off of feelings. We do politics based off of, we don't have realistic expectations with this. And we go into the political arena without an agenda, without a strategy. We do not weaponize the power that we have politically. We believe in people who have constantly shown us that they mean us no good. And if there's to be any real change, systemic change in our communities through politics, then we have to, we got to do better at this. Like, at what point do you stop falling for the banana in the tailpipe? At what point, you know, they say same behavior, same results. And it's like, I'm seeing people begin to, you know, realize this, but more people need to realize this. And I would love for us to begin to do things about this, because I just get frustrated with some of the conversations that maybe not so much in my circle, but just things that I hear people saying when you're watching TV, when you overhear certain circles, and, you know, Biden was Obama's president, a vice president. And did, I mean, it's like all these strange reasons that people have that they're going to vote for someone and they're getting nothing in return.
Wow, you said we fall for the banana in the tailpipe. That sounds like something you would say, Crumb.
Absolutely, absolutely. She speaks very well, very impressed. And I can tell this is going to be great. I agree with everything she's saying, but I'm probably going to come from a completely different angle with it. I guess where I stand on voting, you know, at this particular time, I'm going to go with the master teachers. And not only did Umar Johnson say, you know what, we probably shouldn't be voting right now, but Claude Anderson also said this as well. The very root of this political system is based off capitalism, which is a team sport. And until we can come together and operate homogeneously, we have no need to vote.
We have no need to vote?
Correct.
Okay, Shay, I can see you ain't feeling that.
I was actually in that same space probably, I don't know, it was a long time ago. But like as an adult, I went through a period, so I'm a Christian, and I couldn't figure out like why as a Christian I needed to be involved in the world. That was what the world was doing. And it's funny because now I'm like, as a Christian, I feel obligated to participate in the political system. Because I've realized that politics are just policy, and policy is part of what continues the system of oppression. But yes, it is very much linked to capitalism and economics and business.
You know, what's kind of interesting with me is I've been looking at, you know, I was a political candidate in 2018 and I was considering running in 2020. And for 2020, I'm really looking at the candidates that are discussing their, you know, candidacy. And for 2019, those who are discussing their candidacy. And I'm really kind of moving towards, I haven't gotten there yet totally, but I'm moving towards saying, if you don't support my agenda, I'm just not voting for you. I'm just not voting for you. So I might end up skipping the presidential part of the ballot and vote for the state and vote for the city parts. I might vote, you know, I'm not committing to that right now because I'm not seeing any of the Democrat and I definitely don't see any of the Republican candidates saying that we're going to do some things that are going to truly impact the people that you care for, the things that are part of your agenda. So how does that fit in? Am I falling for the banana in the tailpipe? I don't know.
Well, I want to say this. I believe that part of the problem is in our community, a lot of people are impassioned or indoctrinated about voting, like the vote itself, rather than thinking about the outcomes and the desired results. We're so it's hammered into our head, vote, and then you vote and that's good enough, and you're not thinking about why you're voting or what it is that you are trying to accomplish. It's just, I have to vote, we have to vote, we go and vote and we wear the little sticker and it's like, I voted. And I think that's passion, emotion, somewhat indoctrination. And I think that voting recklessly is just as dangerous as not voting. If we're not strategic with it, then the fear that you just kind of had, or the pause that you had when he mentioned not voting, if we're not going to be strategic with it, then it's not really, I mean, what's the difference? Like, if this is something, because first of all, and then when people use that argument, well, our elders, our ancestors, died for the right for us to be able to vote. They fought and died for us to be able to live our lives a certain way. And they felt that voting was the means in which they could accomplish that. And so, again, we get caught up just on the vote. I'm not necessarily saying don't vote. And I feel like what Shay said, anybody who has been aware of our struggle for a long time, you've gone through a lot of different thought processes. Probably you probably examined things, you've been on this side of it, that side of it, maybe with the same goal, but you've looked. And I've had my times where at one point it would have been crazy to say don't vote, and then I've been like, nah, don't vote. And then kind of like where you're saying, local elections and everything. But I just feel like, if we're not going to use it strategically, just saying that you voted is nothing. Like, stop feeling, don't pop your collar. Like, it's nothing. If it's not strategic, and if we're not focused on specific outcomes for our community, if we are not willing to get down and dirty and, all of these different things, politics is a game, it's an exchange, it's all of these different things. And if we're not willing to do that, like, just don't pop your collar. It's going to be cyclical, the same old same.
Yeah, I know you got something to say, Crumb, but I wanted to say, I've had people say for years, your ancestors gave up their lives for you to have the right, R-I-G-H-T, to vote. And now that we have the right to vote, we need to move from just having the right to being empowered with our vote. And I believe it's a four-step process. First, you get the right to vote, then you vote your heart, and then you become a seasoned, a mature voter, a person who's mature and politically conscious. And then you start voting as a block because you're moving for the greater good. And then you go to the next level, which means you can withhold your vote until you're on the candidate's agenda. So if you're not supporting us, we ain't rocking with you. That's maturity. That's power. The first part, when you get the right to vote, that's the first level. And I think a lot of us are stuck on the first level because we really don't pay attention to politics. We don't know what the politicians are saying. Crumb, you just went in on gay reparations. Most of us didn't even realize that just passed. I definitely want you to talk. Yeah, Shay's like, huh? Yeah. Yeah, so I think that we need to become more politically conscious. And once we're politically conscious, we can understand that we may simply be on level one and we need to move up to level four.
Yeah, I don't know where to start. There's just so many points. I guess I'll start here. Voting is a form of integration. We've had our best times when we segregated. I'll say that. Number two, in terms of voting is integration. Vote is short for vote of confidence. When you vote for this government, you tell them that you have confidence that they can govern your mental, and that is the furthest thing from the truth. Joseph Stalin said, it is enough that the people know there was an election. The people who cast the votes decide nothing. The people who count the votes decide everything. You literally do not have a count. If you ask 9 out of 10 Negroes, they can't tell you anything of significance about the Electoral College. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was not voted in office. He was selected, not elected. Everybody knows this except for us. The number one demographic of non-voters are the Asians. Why do the Asians care not to vote? Because they are masters of their own destiny.
I would not disagree, the whole Asian analogy, and I don't want to get, you know, far off of what we're talking about, but there are reasons that why we're not. I mean, there were a lot of things that were imposed upon us that, you know, made it where we're not masters of our own destiny. I think that's one thing, that one of the major things that we should be working toward. But I mean, Black people just are not that, because like everything that we have accomplished, despite the situations that we have been put under, they always come and thwart it. Like everything, you can name any kind of form of resistance, and we've done it. And then they violently come and shut it down. So I get your point. I just always have to throw out there, like, I don't want that to be misconstrued as if there's something inherently or intrinsically wrong with us.
I would also say, we're not the only ones who don't know anything about the Electoral College. I promise you we're not. This country, period, is ignorant when it comes to how this process works.
Well, you know, I've always had issues when people compare us to different groups, because I think we're incomparable. You can't compare us to different groups. So first of all, you can't compare us to the Asians, because the Asian bloc in general in America didn't have to fight, march, and legislate to get the right to vote. Correct. So we put a lot of collective energy towards that end. And in doing
so, they have their culture. They have their culture intact. Like, one of the biggest things with us, one of the biggest problems with us is that I'm not saying we don't have a culture, that we haven't created culture, but it's within chaos and tumultuous situations and all of these things. They have their culture that extends back, you know, centuries, that has been intact, that they've been able to pass down, passing down culture, passing down wealth, passing down tradition. And I guarantee that has a lot to do with being able to move in which the way that they move. And the lack of that has a lot to do with why we, you know, move in the way in which we move.
I agree 100%. You know, nobody can deny any of the points you all have made, you know, and, honestly, you know, a lot of times the family attacks me even though I'm the messenger. I'm not the one comparing blacks to Asians. I'm not the one comparing blacks to Arabs. They've grouped us into this minority category. So every time they talk, see, you know, it's not Crumb who's making this up. It's them. But when I deliver them, oh, it's Crumb. So what and you know, not saying it's you, but we have been put in the minority category with all these other demographics, you know. So we looking at Kamala Harris, you know, they asked her point blank, are you going to do anything not for minorities? Are you going to do something for black people? And she said, what would I look like doing that? I serve all of the people. And then what? Less than 2 weeks later, she goes and pledges her allegiance to the goddamn state of Israel? To the goddamn state of Israel?
Yo, I was riding for her for a hot second. I really don't see any of the Democratic candidates that I really Yang. What's the guy named? Joseph Yang or
Andrew Yang.
Andrew Yang. I'm kind of digging him. But to be honest with you, I'm not pro-Trump or anti-Trump. Now, I know there are people who are going to definitely disagree with me, but I can survive another 4 years under Trump. Not saying I necessarily want to. And if there's a better option, I'm definitely rocking with the better option. But I'm not just voting anybody to get rid of Trump. And I think many of us are just like, let's just get rid of Trump. Anybody's better than Trump.
So we tend to get blindsided by the media so much. Like, whatever the media tells us, that's the craze or the frenzy at the time, we go along with it, and then we begin to move in that direction. I mean, so there, I've had a lot of people say, you shouldn't be worried about an agenda. You shouldn't be focused on that. You just need to be focused on getting rid of Trump. And I mean, it's very interesting to me that people, even black people, are acting like racism, hate, vitriol, all of these things are things that came along as a result of Trump. These violent attacks and everything, as if they're new. You know, they're able to be, you know, we have social media now. So any and everything that happens can be put up there just like that. And also the liberal media doesn't like him. So anything that happens, they have their, you know, agenda. So they're going to put it out there. But I'm no fan of his. I think he is a blundering idiot. Like I look at him and sometimes I want to laugh, but it's like, oh man, this is real. Like, I'm no, you know, patriot or anything like that, but it's like, yo, they really have a whole idiot, like a real live dumbass up there representing it. And I'm like, wow, this really is stranger than fiction. But just people falling for the acting like, you know, hate is new, and it's just being espoused by him. The only difference with him is that he says what other people were thinking, and he doesn't follow the cult, the mores, and he doesn't do racism in a presidential way. That's all.
I think we're following Trump, looking at Trump. We need to look at his cabinet. Those are the individuals who are writing legislation, advancing bills, and making political decisions under his leadership.
I think we need to look at everybody who is allowing this man to continue to be president, period. I am concerned about another 4 years of Trump because I don't trust that he won't find a way to make it an extra four, an eternity. I feel strongly like he cares not a bit about anything other than continuing to be the center of attention. And he will do whatever it takes to continue to be that way. And the issue is, so I don't agree with anybody but Trump, because Biden. Anyway, but I do understand somewhat the sentiment, and I do see the same issue that we had in 2016 coming in 2020. Like y'all have been saying, like there's nobody. The Democratic Party, unfortunately, we're still in a two-party system. The Democratic Party cannot seem to get any type of understanding of how to actually organize a platform. They're so scattered and there's nothing to unify. Whereas with Trump is unified under what I call American, that's three K's in the middle, American Christianity. Okay, so this is what we came up with. If you're white, if you're a conservative Christian, if you're anti-abortion and pro-guns, that's the people who have traditionally been in positions of power and money, and that's who he's talking to. And they're unified because they've been doing this for 400 and some years.
If I could chime in there, you know, speaking of 400 some years, there's no such thing as a Democrat. There's no such thing as a Republican. These things switch every 50 years because we're not paying attention. The Democrats used to be Republicans, and the Republicans used to be the Whigamores. You know, the Democrats were the racist people on earth. They were the ones who, the Democrats have done nothing to support us. Because initially they were the Dixiecrats, and they didn't even become that until after Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King was a registered Republican because it was the Republicans from 1865 who've been supporting us. But we don't pay attention to anything. Oh, I'm a Democrat. I'm a Republican. Okay, so in 50 years, the Democrats will be the Republicans. It's a game. And just like the sis was saying, stupid is as stupid it does. They've made us look stupid, and Trump is the epitome of that. If anybody still has faith in this kangaroo court after Trump has showed us that this whole thing is rigged, then it's like, okay, you deserve anything that happens to you. Let me say this this as well. You know, I want to be as candid as possible. F Trump, F Barack, F Bush, F Bill, F Daddy Bush, Reagan, James, Gerald, Richard, Lyndon, John, Dwight, Harry, all of them, family. There has been no legislation of significance since 1865 that has been in our best interest. interest. And I know what you're going to say. Hey, Crumb, what about the 13th and 14th Amendment? Again, I will go to Dr. Clyde Anderson. Those things don't even apply to us anymore. The 14th Amendment is exclusively for black people. However, we've been the ones who have benefited the least from anything. What we're dealing with is a people who have been manipulated and continue to be manipulated. What we must do is step away. We must get away from integration. We must get away from voting. We must get away from white people. We must step away from these people. Come and get, just like you were saying, she said, we can't say we're like the Asians because the Asians have a culture. Well, we need to step away and get our culture first. We can't say that we're like the Arabs because the Arabs have an economic base. Well, we need to step away and get our economic base. What we are doing is putting the cart before the horse.
Whoa. Crumb, I tell you, you know, and I need to be very transparent. You know that I ran for 2018. Politically, I'm really an independent. As a voter, I'm an independent. I am a member of the Virginia Beach Democrat Party because some of their practices were aligned with my interests. And I'll probably be so during the, 2020 election as well. But I'll tell you what, 1995, just before I went to the march, there was a lot of talk about removing ourselves from the Democrats and the Republicans, and that would provide power. And I tell you one thing, man, when I run into politicians before I ran, and they would say, hey, I'm a Democrat, so I look forward to your vote. And I was like, you ain't got my vote. You need to do something to get my vote. Their conversation with me changed. Now, I'm just one vote. I'm just one sole person. But when I realized that saying, hey, you haven't earned my vote yet, somebody changed their conversation with me. Then they wanted to find out what I was interested in. I think on a collective basis, it doesn't have to be everybody, because everybody ain't woke. Shay, everybody ain't Christian. everybody's not politically conscious. Everybody's not everything. But if enough of us are loud enough to say, you haven't earned our vote yet, you need to do these things to earn our vote, and we have 8 minutes left, then we will have the change and we will have the agenda. We need to move now from, like I said earlier, getting the right to vote to become empowered with our ability to vote.
So what are the mechanics?
How do we get to
represent, because we're not a monolith. We have different ideas. We range all sides of the political spectrum. We stand on different stances, but I agree completely. Like, even if half of Black America decided, hey, you have to earn our vote together, but how do we get to a point where we are together enough to do that?
Oh, good. In most municipalities, there's a caucus. So, we're all in Hampton Roads. So there's the Hampton Roads Black Caucus. I would say all of us need to join the Hampton Roads Black Caucus and say, all right, we're part of the caucus. All the politicians that run in Hampton Roads, they do come to the caucus events and they get vetted by the caucus. Most of us don't pay attention. So I would say throughout our nation, we need to get involved in those political caucuses that represent our interests, and then force the politicians to come to our events, speak to us, and make sure that we do a thorough vetting. We're doing that in Hampton Roads. We don't have just around, out of the four of us, well, only one of us is involved in Hampton Roads Black Caucus. If all four of us are involved, I'm not sure if you are, Crumb, or not. I doubt it, because you're at voting.
Well, I'm in Atlanta, but just to talk to your point in terms of mechanics, I wanted to add value. We should not be allowed to vote unless we are savvy within that, because the vote is too valuable to be voting ignorantly. What somebody had proposed one time, and this is going to go back to Seiko and why we should vote strategically, as the sis said. So consider this. Let's say we have someone like Seiko in our neighborhood, and we all know, you know what, Seiko's involved. Seiko's pretty, you know, he can kind of speak for all of us, and we trust Seiko. Now, Seiko is responsible, because just like they have it at Top Mechanic, just like they have it at Top, Seiko's responsible for 5,000 votes within, you know, Suffolk, Portsmouth, and Norfolk. So now Seiko represents us as a people. We all come together and say, you know, I'm not paying attention. I'm going to be transparent. I'm not paying attention. I'm going to have Seiko in authority of my vote. They've already talked about this. This isn't something Crumb Snatcher, slobbering, you know, genius or something, or madman has come up with. It's already been brought up in terms of mechanics and how we can change the way we vote, and maybe even a system to where we can have a more powerful, informed vote versus, you know, all of us playing a guessing game.
Stay fly. Stay
well,
fly.
That's what the Black caucuses do. And that's what caucuses do. And, you know, I would say that I would love to see somebody like Shay, or definitely would love to see Starr get involved in the political process. So we need more of us involved in the political process. And we also need to support our caucuses, because the things we just talked about, our caucuses are set up currently to do.
So two, three quick things I want to say. For one, I think that there should be a class put together that is like politics for dummies. It doesn't have to be called that, but it could be in churches. And I say that because that's still a place where a lot of the most Black people congregate at once regularly. So, you know, in churches, in mosques, fraternities, sororities, all of these places where Black people are en masse, and you have politics for dummies, and incentivize that shit and get it some way where we learn, you know, politics. You know, we need that. One, two, I told you, Seiko, about the Black think tank. I think that there should be, and not a think tank that just comes around to think, but with the goal, we need Black people who are have minds like we, who have an agenda like us, someone who is an economist, someone who is an urban planner, someone who is understands like the ins and outs of education, someone who, you know, we have these ideas, but then you have the people who have the expertise in these things and come together and put an agenda together, an agenda in which you can come up with 3 to 5 things that I think all most Black people, not all, but most Black people agree that we're pissed off about, or we want to see happen, and we want to see change. And then we have that agenda, because coming together in a caucus, going to candidates and saying you need to earn my vote, well, what do I need to do to earn your vote? So we need to be able to say A, B, C, D, and E. This is what needs to happen. And those are the things that I would propose that, you know, we need to do in this simultaneously back, like, you know, I and Crumb were saying, also building up our culture. You know, constantly with any work that we're doing, we always got to, you know, make sure that Black people understand who we are, you know, how we are, how we got to be in the condition that we're in, and that we love who we are. Because if I constantly in my work hear Black children who don't love being Black, okay? So all of these things, I think, are wrapped, that would be my proposal.
I'm loving it. Last words. We have about 2 minutes left. You know, the Fly Guys podcast is all about practical consciousness. And as I've said before, you know, we can discuss Black consciousness. We can talk about health consciousness. We can discuss political consciousness. We can talk about spiritual consciousness. Today, we're kind of dealing with political consciousness. Last words, Shay. What's the last word?
I want to say that Starr is exactly right. Education is the key, because we need to know things. History makes a huge difference in understanding. And I think just as a point of fact, we missed an opportunity with Governor Northam in Virginia with the blackface situation, because nobody held his feet to the fire, including the caucus, which is, to your point.
Get him, sis! Get him, sis!
Okay. Whoa.
Where the Black caucus at?
The caucus's response to the governor was kind of lightweight. Good point. And you know, if Danny were here, if Dan Trezoma were here, he would say, hey, listen to the women, listen to the Black women first. So I'm glad that we're kind of supporting what Shay says. So Shay, last words. I mean, Starr, last words.
I mean, I feel like I kind to summarize how I feel, but to piggyback off of what Shay just said, they should have quarterbacked that. Like, they had him by his balls, and instead of saying resign, it's like, I got you by your balls. And because everybody was looking for, what are black people going to say? And that's the point where I got you backed in a corner. So basically, if you want me to let these balls go, then this is what you need to do. But he ran that situation. He said, and I am telling you, I'm not going. And he didn't go. And he wrote it out, and he did it his way. He did it his way. So we got to learn how to, again, politics, get shrewd, stop being friends with these people. Be, look, what is your commitment to the black community? Because at the end of the day, mine is not to Barack, Michelle, a pretty family, a pretty picture, anything like that. It is to the advancement of our people, of my community, and these babies coming up behind us. That's what it is. That's it. Not a person, not a
I say, stay woke, in peace. I am your brother, Crumb. In peace.
We are the Crumb Snatcher. Get snatched. Our content is conscious, edgy, and pro-black. Our goal is to uplift and percent enlighten our people. Trigger warning. Some of you will disagree with the Crumb Snatcher. We are not concerned with being politically correct. We are thought-provoking. Some of you are gonna think that we're angry. You are wrong. Yet you're gonna enjoy the ride. Join our antics in conscious thought and new reality. Get snatched.
The views expressed on this podcast are not the views of Positive Vibes Inc., its staff, sponsors, or owners.
I love you. Life, your words are magic. I'm your humble brother.
We are the Crumb Snatcher.